welcome to the State We're In podcast. In today's episode, we take a closer look at the work being done to ensure that the transgender and non-binary community have the care and support needed to live their healthiest lives. We were fortunate to connect with six community leaders, including two who are leading this work within Blue Cross. First, we'll hear from Ani Koch, who is a principal sustainability design consultant and leads the gender care initiative at Blue Cross, and Alex Jackson Nelson, Blue Cross's gender services consultant. Later on in the episode, Ani will be joined by Ejay Jack from mHealth Fairview and Dr. Angela Kade Goepferd from Children's Minnesota. Let's listen.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Ani Ryan Koch. My pronouns are they, them, or he, him, and I'm a principal sustainability design consultant on the population health team. I've been working on gender services here at Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Minnesota for about 5 years. Before we get into our interviews with some of these amazing guests, my colleague Alex and I are going to provide a bit of an overview and some key terms and concepts that you'll hear today. Alex?
Hey, everyone. I'm Alex Jackson Nelson. I use he, him pronouns, and I'm the gender services consultant here at Blue Cross Blue Shield. I've been here for about 10 months. It's a brand new position, and my position was created to serve transgender and gender non-binary members, folks who have Blue Cross Blue Shield of Minnesota insurance, and kind of navigating through the insurance tangles that can happen for trans and non-binary folks and providing them resources for providers who are trans-friendly and competent, whether that's mental health providers or physical health doctors, things like that.
We'd like to just talk through some of the concepts that you're going to hear throughout the episode. The first one that we'll cover is a distinction between sex assigned at birth, gender identity, gender expression, and sexual orientation.
So something we all have in common is that we all have these four things. When we talk about sex, we're talking about the sex that we were assigned at birth. So when a baby comes out, generally a doctor looks at their genitals and assigns them a sex. That's why we say sex assigned at birth. Gender identity can be described as our psychological sense of self. Who are we as a human being? How do we think and feel about ourselves? There's all sorts of words that we can use to describe our gender identity. And again, goes back to psychologically, what is our sense of self? Male, female, both, neither, gender queer, gender variant, cisgender, non-gendered, right? All sorts of language we can use for that. Then the third distinction is gender expression. When we talk about gender expression, what we're meaning is the characteristics and behaviors of how someone appears, dresses, speaks, what they look like, how that fits into societal norms or not. And then sexual orientation is who we're attracted to. If all of those things match with what society's expectation is of what my gender expression looks like, then I might not have to think about any of those things very much at all. If they don't match, then I have to prove to people why there is no match there or what's wrong with me. I say that in air quotes, right? Or what's happening that's different and why is that happening? And not just convince people of that, but I have to figure it out myself first. And then in order to have medical, you know, intervention there, oftentimes I have to convince people that there's something about my gender that's not aligned with my sex assigned at birth. So next, we're going to walk through some commonly used terms, specifically the distinctions between binary and non-binary and transgender and cisgender.
The word binary refers literally to two. So when we think about gender, binary gender would be male and female. Non-binary then would be not involving just two things. It would be in terms of gender or gender identity, someone who identify as something different than male or female, outside of male or female, in between male or female, but not just male or female. Transgender then is an umbrella term that's used to describe people whose gender identity and or expression is different from their gender that is assigned at birth. Cisgender, or short term cis, is a term that describes people whose gender identity or gender expression is the same as their gender that was assigned at birth. Another topic that you'll hear discussed throughout the episode or shared at the start of an interview are about pronouns. So for me, when I hear someone share what their gender pronouns are, it says to me that the person is trying to communicate, this is how I feel respected. This is who I am. This is how I need to be referred to. And that's it. It is akin towards sharing other information about yourself.
So I appreciate when people offer them up because it allows me to use them seamlessly and to not think about it. It also forces me to not make assumptions.
I feel like I've seen a lot more people recently sharing their pronouns, talking about pronouns, asking other people what their pronouns are. I'm also going to say, you know, a lot of people have asked me, when did you stop using this pronoun or start using this pronoun? And the truth is, prior to someone asking me how I wanted to be addressed, I didn't use pronouns at all. Other people were using them for me. And so to be able to just respond to that question and say, this is how you can respectfully refer to me, that's when my pronouns changed. And it wasn't really a change for me. That had always been who I was internally.
I wanted to ask you, Ani, when you were describing or defining transgender and cisgender, what's the power of language? And we'll talk more about that, the power of language. But why would it, if transgender and cisgender are two terms, I as a transgender person use the word transgender or trans often in identifying myself and the community in which I live. And but I wonder what are your thoughts about cisgender? When would a person use it? If somebody uses it in your company, how does that impact you?
Again, this is something that I've seen come up more recently. And I think that it's becoming more widely used because folks are understanding the importance of not just defining the, you know, minority or the marginalized group, but instead recognizing that, you know, there's transgender and then there's folks who are not transgender and those folks are cisgender. And so rather than having it be defined as what is and what is not, it's an opportunity to define both populations of people. And I think there's a lot of power in that.
What impact does it have on you when you're hanging out with a group of people and maybe you're meeting new people that you haven't met before and somebody uses the word cisgender? What impact does that have on you? What does it change, if anything, in the building of that relationship?
If someone uses the word cisgender around me, it typically is a cue to me that they have an understanding of their gender identity, and just gender issues overall. And frankly, it creates an environment where it feels easier for me to be who I am or for them to get to know me better.
Yeah. And you know, I have similar experiences to that, and thinking that, you know, it brings me a sense of safety, right? Like maybe they've thought about, well, what if I was at, you know, the coffee shop or the bar or the grocery store and I had to go to the bathroom and there was no bathroom that I could access safely as a trans person. So I appreciate that too. When folks, it just means to me, when folks identify as cisgender, to me, it's this opening to me of like, oh, I get to share my identity too, and I get to share my history. I get to just talk about what my life has looked like openly. And this person is generally going to get it, or at least understand that there are more genders that exist than just two.
Right. It says, I've thought about this.
Yeah.
Right. And that indication goes a really long way, especially in building an initial relationship.
So can we talk about another term that is going to be used in this podcast? The term is clocking. Clocking is a term that's used by some transgender, I use trans for short, and non-binary folks. And it reflects that someone transgender, usually they're talking about themselves, right? Like they've been out in the world and they've been recognized as a transgender person or however they identify outside of the binary spectrum, right? So somebody's seen them and thought, oh, that's a trans person. And usually that's happening when the person is trying to blend in with cisgender people around them. So they're just trying to do their day, walking downtown, whatever. And they might use language like, oh, I got clocked today, meaning somebody was staring at me. They could tell from whatever features I have, or I think they could tell. that I'm a trans person, and that the person is not intending to be seen as anything other than the gender they're presenting at that moment.
Yeah. So in terms of clocking, you know, and safety, one of the things that I think about is that folks are just living their lives. I mean, trans people are just in the world, living their lives, trying to go to the store, trying to use the restroom, trying to just exist. And clocking is something that I feel like interrupts that existence or challenges them for who they are in the moment. And I think one of the most common scenarios that comes up with this is that someone sees or hears maybe a secondary sex characteristic, a voice, hair, a way that they expect someone to be, and they challenge that. And as a result, it puts that person in harm's way. We see it all the time. This is why bathroom access is so important. You see someone, you know, go into a bathroom and they come out, they just are trying to use the bathroom. And someone has to comment on it. Oh, you're in the right one. You're in the wrong one. There's not one for you. There is one for you. Rather than just let the person use the bathroom.
Yep.
So that's a common place where I think it happens. I want to thank everyone for listening today. We're excited for you to hear the community interviews. Sharing these stories is a part of Blue Cross and Blue Shield's commitment to ensuring equitable care for the transgender and non-binary community.
The healthcare system is complex, and helping people navigate it is essential. Many parts of the healthcare system are committed to supporting care coordination and navigation support, including Blue Cross. Ejay Jack has been guiding this work at mHealth Fairview's Comprehensive Gender Care Program for years, providing a crucial connection between the healthcare system and the community.
Ejay, thank you so much for joining us. I'm really happy to talk to you this morning. Just wondering if you could start off by sharing a little bit about yourself.
Sure. I'm the transgender care coordinator and social worker, and I guess essentially the program manager at mHealth Fairview's Comprehensive Gender Care Program. So I do a lot of work with the trans and non-binary population. And, you know, I'm connected to the work because I'm trans-identified and understand what it's like navigating healthcare systems, and also as a social worker, navigating and advocating for patient access to care. So I've been doing sort of LGBTQ care education from college on, and I worked extensively in HIV and STI care for a long time, and helped build access to PrEP programs, pre-exposure prophylaxis for preventing HIV infections and various things. So I've kind of always done LGBTQ health. And then most recently with this work at mHealth Fairview, building a gender care program specifically for trans and non-binary folks. So it's been a rich work and life experience, I suppose, birthing these programs and trying to, you know, do the best I can for our community.
So thinking about all of that rich experience, your current role and your past work, what do you think of when I say equitable healthcare? What does that mean to you?
It means so many things. And when speaking specifically about, you know, gender care, I look at the short-term goals of programs like ours and across the country of these gender care programs, and, you know, really trying to build internal resources for a healthcare system to become more affirming to trans and non-binary folks. Then I think about it in a larger scale and think about, you know, long-term, what would it mean to not have these programs, and how do we invest the resources that we need so that we don't need specific so-called diversity programs where healthcare can just be responsive to the person that's in front of them, regardless of gender, age, race, ethnicity, language, ability, status, all of these things.
What's something that you would want listeners of this podcast to know about trans folks and their healthcare needs?
So when working with trans folks, I think it's really important that they partner with someone like myself or someone that they trust that can help them through navigating healthcare, because because there's lots of different players involved, right? So there's the provider who's looking out for their health, hopefully, right? Let's assume a gender-affirming, you know, provider. And so understanding that, you know, they have certain constraints and they're, you know, trying to make sure that the care that they're providing is going to be safe for the patient. And then I think you have like, you know, WPATH, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, who's like the guiding body that providers look to. And then you've got, you know, payers or insurance companies, you know, they're the ones that are, you know, paying for the care essentially. And all three players, meaning the provider, WPATH, and insurance companies, all have a piece of the puzzle that the patient needs to understand. And there's usually not one person that's connecting all of them, right? So that's what like my program or what I try to do is help folks understand, you know, what the limitations are and what the possibilities are of each of those three, you know, parties, if you will. It's super confusing. And so understanding all how they interact and the flow, so helping people understand all of those roles and getting paperwork and taking notes, and because everybody speaks a different language. So I think understanding those aspects are incredibly important. And then I think about, depending on the listener, if there are providers out there who want to provide trans affirmative healthcare, how important it is to partner with people who are already doing the work and the community, and being humble and empathic and understanding this historical context of trans healthcare and the way that trans people and non-binary folks have been treated in this country and then globally.
Just share a little bit about, you know, from your perspective, healthcare access and what are the issues currently facing the trans community?
So when I think about healthcare access, how do we basically get people the care they need? And it gets really frustrating for people. And I totally understand it because, again, a lot of times we don't speak the same language. And it's just hard to access and understand, like, you know, understand the language. And then patients, if they're not embedded in a healthcare system like I am, you know, it just seems like totally confusing and gobbledygook and you know, and that increases anxiety. So, which I get.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, I do think it's a pretty unique situation that kind of what we expect of transgender people in terms of navigating their care. And if they don't have access to someone like you, we've seen the value and we've added the same concept of a role anyway, yeah. Right? In gender services. But without those navigation roles and folks kind of being on their own, there's kind of an extra layer of navigation that comes into trans care because of historically the way that trans healthcare and people's bodies and their healthcare needs have been regulated or some people would say policed. Yeah. Or, you know.
Yeah, we need to build access by assisting these patients like other patients have for specialty care, because this is a specialty area. And so I think about what does that look like and how can we build out these programs to reach sort of that bigger picture that I was talking about where we don't need it anymore. You know, what does that look like? I mean, primary care physicians in centers that do gender affirming care don't have a trans care coordinator. And we need more providers to be trained. I mean, then we can talk about like medical, you know, education and the fact that med students only get 1 to 2 hours, I think is the average or something like that, of LGBTQ care. And then, you know, gender-related care is even more specialized than LGB care. We need more providers because, you know, our surgical team is small and that's, you know, replicated across this country and internationally as well. And so there's a lot of work to be done in this area for sure.
What could healthcare do better to partner with the trans community?
I think there needs to be a true, authentic approach to listening to what trans people are saying. The decision makers, the people that hold the purse strings that can, you know, fully, authentically reach out and listen and hear what community needs. Yeah, it just, I think having a commitment from the highest levels, from CEOs, from medical directors, and taking a methodical approach to saying we're going to invest we're going to, you know, support and build a program like ours to ensure that we can reduce wait times to get into the clinic, to reduce, you know, barriers of care, to ensure that we're addressing, you know, patient relations complaints, to make sure that we're training the healthcare staff from the greeters or the, you know, valet staff to the checkout staff, right? The whole continuum. So that's what I think, you know, needs to happen.
You know, Ejay, something that you're describing is that, I mean, the navigation and the support and everything that you provide to patients, community members is a critical role within the system, but it's just one part. And there's so many other places where folks have to engage to get their care needs met. And so, again, going back to that transition of is it on one person and one program, or do we all need to kind of take accountability for this? And I just think it's really important. So I wanted to highlight that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So I wonder, you know, we've spent some time talking about, you know, your role and the work that you do to help navigate care. I'm wondering if you can tell me what's going well in the area of trans healthcare.
I think that there are more and more primary care providers doing hormonal cares where people can obtain their ongoing primary care with their specialty hormone care. And I think that that's the model that best addresses trans healthcare because it's most accessible. So for the majority of people, you know, having primary care providers trained and educated, either in medical school, which I think is starting to increase, which is a good thing, but adding primary care physicians to referral sources. So that's going really well. I think that there's a move away from transition-related care being central or equated with mental health care. I think that we need to think about transition-related care as primarily medical care, and understanding that we live in a society that, you know, makes it very difficult for trans folks. And so we do need mental health care to help us cope with discrimination and transphobia and all of those things. But moving these programs out from under mental health care, which we've been seeing as a trend, is really important.
I feel like we're seeing those themes in other countries, this recognition that, you know, we've been kind of using this as a mental health diagnosis to get people's care needs met, but ultimately the interventions are typically medical, and that, you know, mental health care really has to do with stigma and societal bias put on folks. So thank you for that. If there are folks listening, and this is maybe the first time that they thought about equitable care for trans folks or the barriers that folks might be facing, I'm wondering, how would you recommend someone start their learning journey around that?
Yeah, I think this is a great question, because I think what people initially want to do is go to whomever they may think or know are trans and start asking them super personal questions, which is not the right way to go. So the right way to learn more about this is to do some research on your own. You know, the Fenway Institute, they have an LGBTQ health education that's free, that you have to sign up for, and they're fantastic. So, you know, finding resources like that are reputable, and doing some education on their own to understand the lived experience of trans people, the historical trauma of trans people, and then the specific healthcare needs of trans people. And then, you know, at that point, maybe, you know, joining a book club so that they can discuss with somebody else, and then partnering with community in an authentic way. Doing this type of self-education and then having some authentic dialogues is really important, and not coming in thinking that they can be the savior, because there's already people doing the work, and particularly for cis people, cisgender people, people who are not transgender, coming in is to really understand that having the lived experience, and there are professionals that have the lived experience and the professional experience, need to be centered, and being conscientious of their positionality when doing this work.
That's wonderful. Thank you. And finally, what gives you hope?
This is where I always tear up. I think young people and their families give me hope, because I just know what it's like to be young and trans and not be able to talk to anybody. And so I see these families come in, or I get these calls. You can hear me quivering in my voice, from parents who are frantic to find information and accurate information, and are just sponges and just want to help their kiddos. And I think that that really brings me hope, because it's their advocacy that's going to keep these young people alive. And that's really needed, because, you know, suicide's an epidemic within the trans community. And so I think young people and their perseverance to be who they are, and then their parents that are supporting them, they're the ones that give me hope. So I think one takeaway that a community partner always tells our mutual patients is that when folks hear no from a provider or an insurance company or a parent or whoever, whenever you kind of hear no in regards to a transition, like people are seeking transition related care, and that something's denied, or a provider saying that, you know, you can't have this or that, is that that's not the end all be all answer. There's other ways to find a yes, or there's other ways to find the pathway. Is it frustrating? Yes, but there are pathways forward. And so it's a matter of partnering with the right people, knowing authentically that, you know, that you need this. And so there will be a pathway to access the care that you need. And so I think just being able to persevere through that, and keeping folks' heads up high and finding the right support is key.
Yeah, I think that's super important. It can be devastating to tell someone, this is who I am and this is what I need, and for someone to respond back with no and I know better. And I think what you're describing is the resilience that our community needs to have to move forward and to know, okay, this path didn't work, there's another path.
Supporting people who identify as transgender and non-binary is critical, and this is especially true for children who are exploring their gender identity. Dr. Angela Kade Goepferd from Children's Minnesota has been a leader and advocate in advancing equitable healthcare for all children.
Hi, thanks so much for joining us today, Dr. Goepferd. Can we start out? Maybe you could just share a little bit about yourself.
Sure. I am Dr. Angela Kade Goepferd. I use she and they pronouns, and I am a pediatrician at Children's Minnesota, which is the largest freestanding pediatric health system in the region. And I've been a pediatrician there for about 15 years. I see kids in primary care, and then I also act as our medical director for our gender health program, which is a multi-specialty pediatric clinic that provides gender-affirming care for transgender and gender-diverse kids. I also am our chief education officer and current chief of staff for the health system, so I play a pretty big role in the leadership of our organization, as well as making sure we get education out to people who are training to become clinicians and people who are already practicing. I also am a parent, so I have three kids of my own, three kids who are 7, 7, and 5. I've lived in Minnesota for 21 years now, so even though I was not born here, I very much consider myself to be a Minnesotan, and more specifically, a Minneapolitan at this point. I've lived in Minneapolis for that long. So that's me.
You know, something that you said, even just in your introduction, I'm wondering if you could expand on a little bit. When you say gender-affirming care, what do you mean by that?
Yeah, I think it means a few things. I mean, I think one, it means a safe place for parents and kids to go and talk about their gender identity. And honestly, that's a lot of what we do for kids from all ages, from young kids, 4 or 5 years old, up to older kids who are 17, 18 years old. Really just a place to ask questions about gender identity, to find out more information. So that's a lot of what we do. And when I do training about gender-affirming care, a lot of times I'm talking to people who aren't providing care that's specific to transgender kids. They're just providing general pediatric care, but in a gender-affirming way, where they're using a kid's name and pronoun, they're being really respectful of their identity. What we do, though, in our clinic, in addition to that, is provide medical interventions for kids who need them, who identify as transgender, and who need medical help so that their bodies fit with their identities.
I'm wondering if you could speak to then the importance of transgender and gender diverse kids having access to gender affirming care.
Yeah, it's really important. I think having a place to ask questions first and foremost is very important. Often parents and kids don't even know if they can talk to their primary care providers about their children's identities and are worried that they might not know how to answer questions or that there might be judgment there. So just having a safe space to talk about identity is really, really, really important. The access to the specific medical care itself is pretty critically important for kids and in some cases can be life-saving. So for those who are listening who aren't very familiar with trans and gender diverse kids, they experience significant amounts of harassment. Up to 80% of them are harassed in their schools. Many of them are rejected by their parents, up to 60% of them. And many of them struggle with suicidality. Trans and gender diverse kids experience 8 to 9 times the suicidal thoughts of other kids who are cisgender or not LGBTQ. So for these kids to have a place to talk that's safe, for them to have a place that will affirm them and support them in their identities and to help them access medical care that they need so that they can live their lives as themselves is critically important.
Yeah, that is so, so important. And I feel like one of the things just listening to you talk about this in terms of clinical care is the changes that happen in what care is available, what's accepted, what's evidence-based. I just feel like the field is rapidly changing. And I wonder if you could speak to that at all. What in your mind has changed over the last 5 years? Where are we going?
Yeah, there's a lot that's changed over the last 5 years. I really feel like the change probably started about 10 years ago, but really within the last 5 years, we have a few things. One, we have guidelines. So, you know, for anyone who's listening, who's really worried that we're experimenting with kids or we're doing things that aren't safe, we have guidelines that we follow that are not only reviewed and endorsed by professional societies here in the United States, but also really worldwide. So the guidelines that we follow in our clinic are those that are endorsed by the Pediatric Endocrine Society. And those are also aligned with the WPATH, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health. And they have a US branch as well called USPATH. So we have guidelines. We're not just doing rogue medicine. We're actually following clinical guidelines that have been studied and that have outcomes and things like dosing guidelines that we're following. So this is real medicine. It's real science. There are real guidelines that we're following. We now have some research. When I started in this field 10 years ago, we had very little research on trans kids. There were some international studies that were done on small cohorts of kids. But now we have much larger studies. So we now really do have data on outcomes, both mental health outcomes and physical health outcomes for kids. So I think that helps us, one, know that we're doing the right thing and also helps guide us to how we do the right thing and how we practice the medicine. So I think those are two really significant things that have changed in the field of gender health. And I think the third thing that's changed is just the world is different. You know, there are a lot more kids now who are identifying as trans and gender diverse than ever before. So if you look at adult studies, you'll see that usually they quote somewhere between 1 to 1.5% of adults identify as transgender. If you look at the 2018 Minnesota Student Survey, you'll see that close to 3% of kids identify in the state of Minnesota as trans or gender diverse. So that's almost twice to three times the rate of the adult population. There was just a study that came out this past week, in fact, that showed that Gen Zers, who are young adults between the ages of 19 and 25, that 1 in 6 of them identifies as LGBTQ. So those are much higher numbers than we've ever had before. So the world is changing, kids' identities are changing, kids are feeling more open to being themselves. They're seeing more examples of what it means to be male or female or something in between than they've ever seen before. And so it really is, having an effect on the way that kids are able to understand themselves now in ways that they might not have had access to that information until they were much older. And unfortunately, might not even survive that process in the past. And thankfully, now we're giving kids some options to explore who they are safely and supported and evidence-based. So when I'm talking with kids and families, I like to really separate out the idea of your gender identity, who you see yourself as, and your gender expression, how you like to show yourself to the world. So we know in young kids, there is a big variety of gender expression. So kids, particularly when they're younger, from the ages of 2 to 5, just do a ton of exploring of gender expression. They like to see what clothes they like to, wear. They like to try out all kinds of, different toys. I have yet to meet a child who doesn't want to see what nail polish looks like on their fingernails, regardless of their sex assigned at birth. So, there's a lot of exploring that happens in those young ages. And a lot of that is expression. It's not identity. And so it's really important to make that distinction. There's a big difference between a child who wants to dress up like Elsa for Halloween because they just saw the movie Frozen, and a child who refuses to wear anything but dresses and wants to be referred to with she pronouns and insists that they're a girl or a sister. So there's a nuance there. And that's, why, in my opinion, it is really important to help parents and help kids talk with specialists who have some expertise in this area to help them sort that out. I think that many parents want to do what's best for their kids and want to support their kids, but have questions about what best is. They have questions about what do I encourage and what do I discourage? What is my child trying to send me a message or not trying to send me a message? And that can get quite confusing. So I think to talk with a clinical team, both medical and mental health team, that has some experience with that can be really, really helpful for families.
So, yeah. And I'm wondering, when you do come to a point and, we realize, okay, we have a gender diverse kid or we have someone who's transgender, what kind of barriers do those kids in particular face?
They face a lot of barriers, unfortunately, which, coincidentally, many parents are aware of. And that is one of their biggest resistance points is that, they kind of wish in some ways often that their child was not transgender because they know the number of barriers that they're going to have to face, even if they love and support their kid's identity. So barriers for transgender kids really range across their life. So they can have barriers within their own family. I mentioned earlier that close to 60% of transgender kids do not experience acceptance by their parents and experience rejection. So they can really face barriers to being themselves at home, being themselves around the people who they love the most. They face a lot of barriers at school. Our world is incredibly gendered. Everything from haircuts to clothing styles, the ways we group kids in a school setting are very gendered. So I'll just give an example of my own kids. I went to observe their kindergarten class, and we were going to do a walk down to the lake from their classroom. And I saw all the kids run into the gym, and then they sat in rows, a row of girls and a row of boys. And I found that peculiar. And I thought there might be a reason for it. And there was no reason for it. That's just how they sit in gym class every day. And, for my kids who were in that class, who identify as boys, they're cisgender boys, it didn't mean much to them. But because of the work I do, I thought about the transgender or gender diverse kids that might be in their class and how every day they would have to make a decision of which line they sat in, And there was really no reason for that. They could have just had the kids, sit in lines by class or by any other designation. So there's a lot of gendering that happens for young kids, and that becomes a barrier for them. Bathrooms. So 68% of kids who are transgender will not use the bathroom one time during the school day. They will limit how much they drink and avoid having to go to the bathroom because they often are prohibited from using the bathroom. That correlates with their identity. So bathrooms become an issue for kids at school. Sports teams. Which sports teams are they allowed to participate in? There's a lot of attacks going on across the country for transgender kids in sports. And then you get to the medical care. So all of that is outside of medical care. And then you get to medical care. And it's a matter of, you know, is there, like I said, is there anyone who understands this? Does my primary care doctor understand this? Is there a clinic in my area that I can access? So having access to that care. Once you get into the system and you see someone who can help provide you care, then what's going to happen with your insurance company? Will the treatments that are necessary for your child be denied? Will they be too expensive for you to afford? And I think, you know, the barriers kind of go on from there, but those are the ones that immediately come to mind for transgender kids who are really just trying to, you know, be their best selves and you know, live in a fulfilled way with their identities, and it can be really challenging for them.
To hear more of this conversation with Dr. Goepferd, along with community leaders Ms. July 23rd and Nathalie Crowley, listen to part 2, which is available now as episode 20 of The State We're In. Many thanks to Ani Koch, Alex Jackson Nelson, Ejay Jack, and Dr. Angela Kade Goepferd for their contributions to this episode. You can learn more about each of our contributors at our website, centerforpreventionmn.com/podcast. Funded through proceeds from Blue Cross's historic lawsuit against the commercial tobacco industry, the Center for Prevention works with organizations statewide to make healthy choices possible for all Minnesotans. By tackling the leading causes of preventable disease, commercial tobacco use, physical inactivity, and unhealthy eating, we advance health equity to transform communities and create a healthier state. This episode was produced by me, Jason Dahm, and Katie Schultz. Follow the Center for Prevention on Facebook to keep in touch. And for more info on this episode, please visit centerforpreventionmn.com/podcast. That's centerforpreventionmn.com/podcast. If you are a Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Minnesota member and would like more information about our gender-related care and navigation support, visit bluecrossmn.com/gendercare. That's bluecrossmn.com/gendercare. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Minnesota is a nonprofit independent licensee of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Association.